We need prayer and we need more of God. Amen. That's why we are here. We are not here because we have to. We are here because we are part of a vision and a mission for a nation. Amen. And it's called revival. So let's open our Bibles and Revelation chapter 1. We're going to read verse 8 this morning. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence among us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being our pastor and our leader. Revelation chapter 8, 1 verse 8. The Bible says this: I am the Alpha and the Omega. This is Jesus speaking, eh? Jesus speaking right here in the Word. And it says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord. And I want to read that last part right there because it says this: who is, who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. And I like this because it says, not that he is, not that he was, not that he will be, but it like this says, is, and he is to come. And I believe Jesus is closer than ever. Signs and wonders are moving around the globe, and prophecies are going to be fulfilled in these days. Yesterday, they had a great, a massive event in California. They call it Azusa Now, and thousands came to gather together and to worship Jesus. And I believe Jesus is about to come, and the church, we as a church, we need to be ready for his coming back. Amen. And we have to present a church that is willing to do his will and be willing to have a great harvest and among in this nation. Amen. So, Father, we are here this morning. We are here to declare this. You are the Alpha. You are the Omega. You are the beginning and the end. Nothing matters if you are not there, God. And everything that exists is because of you. Father, we don't want to put our eyes in religion and or maybe in another meeting. Another meeting in the week. But we want to have our eyes in Jesus today. We want to put our eyes in our Savior. We want to understand that it's by grace and by your mercy that we are here in the pulpit, that we are here in the church. Because, Father, you cleanse us and now you anoint us to be part of the great body of Christ worldwide, Lord. Many, many churches right now in this hour are worshiping together. So we join those churches. We join the body of Christ this morning in worship and praise. And we open our lips today. Come on, open your lips right now. Hey, Jesus. We want to glorify you today. Whoa. It's a privilege to serve you. It's a privilege to honor you, God. Whoa, you are the Alpha, the Omega. You are our Heavenly Father. You are that it was, you are that it is, and you are that it is to come. Because you're coming back, Jesus. And we want to wait for you with expectation. We want to wait for you, Father, like the virgins that he has the fire in the lamp. Hey, we don't want to wait our beloved Jesus with our lamps in the darkness. We want to keep the oil flowing. And Jesus, we are here for you and by you. So we are so thankful and so happy to be here in your presence. Because now, God, we understand that it's not about us, but it's about you, Jesus. We sing a song because we love you. Because we honor you. Not because we like it or because I don't sing this one because I don't like it. No. We do this. We serve you. And we do everything here because we love you, Lord. Because your love has conquered my heart. And it's for you that I live, Jesus. Nothing else matters. No richness, no fame. Nothing in the world can satisfy our hearts as you glory, the glory of your Holy Spirit. So this morning we welcome you and we say, lead us. Lead us this morning, Lord. Remove distractions. Remove any thoughts, any feelings. Remove any burdens in our hearts. Allow us to be free today. Free to open our lips. Free to dance. And free to glorify the name that has above all names, Father. The name of Jesus Christ. The light of the world. The Lamb. Whoa. Come on, just worship Him for a moment. Worship Him with a moment with your lips. Come on, give Him glory. We don't have to wait for the sun to begin. You can worship right now with your lips. Come on, honor the King of Kings. He's coming back for His church. He's coming back for us to be with Him for eternity. Yes, glorify Him with your own lips. With your words. He's in the house. His glory is among us. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, welcome. Welcome in this house. Hallelujah.
So I invite you to worship the Lord the way that you learn to do it. Remember the first day that the Lord encountered you. Remember that first day. Remember how you worship Him in that moment. I know it sounds crazy, but I invite you to do it the same way that you did it that day. If you were, you know, in your knees, bow down to the Lord, do it. If you were singing, jumping, running, walking, remember how the Lord encountered you. Your first time. Remember that. How was it? Were you crying in your knees? Were you jumping and running? Were you praying with all your heart? Were you singing? Remember that day? It's a day of joy, because that day was a party in heaven, because you were safe. So remember that moment, that date. You to do the same thing that you were doing that moment. I was laughing so experiencing a joy. The sadness that I had for years was gone, and I was laughing so hard. Remember that moment. Did you feel love? Did you feel happy? It's not the moment that your parents told you to do it, no. It was the moment that you felt the Lord, that the Lord encountered you. For the first time ever. Walking or wherever I was, there was always hate, people swearing, people fighting. I couldn't smile. It was always sadness in my heart. When Jesus encountered me, he found me. That depression, that sadness, went away from me. And I started laughing and smiling so hard. Everything that you have done. you be that sincere. In those times, have you be that sincere? As you went that first time, sometimes we just pray, oh Lord, forgive me. But we are not that sincere as we did it at that time. Our negligence. Forgive our sin. Forgive our iniquity. Forgive our thoughts. Forgive our words. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us, Jesus. Us, Holy Spirit, because we don't listen to you. We just do it when we are in trouble. Forgive us because you said that everything that the Father wants to say to us is in the Bible, and read it. It's like we want to hear from our Father, but we don't do anything for it. Oh Lord, we open our hearts this morning, and we open our minds, as you said in the Bible. We come to you with hearts of repentance, asking for forgiveness and to cleanse us and to use us, because we know that we have a bigger calling that we are doing it right now. Our calling is bigger than what we're doing right now. Our calling is bigger. It's bigger, a lot bigger. That just go and read the Bible and work, and that's it. Our calling is bigger. We should go to the nations and do what he wants us to do, but we are not doing it because we have our plans. And everything. And everything is taking your place. Spirit, I know that you are in this place. We don't have to tell you to come. We are in this place already. I can see in the spirit realm that he's touching every one of you. He's touching every one of you. And I'm perceiving that you need this moment. A moment when you are not thinking in anything else, just him. A moment that you are not thinking in your family, when your work, or your school, or the past, or social media. This is a moment that you really need to. This week you have been so busy that you haven't gone in his presence like right now. Yes, you pray. Yes, you read the Bible. Yes, you did your devotional. You haven't been in his presence like you are right now. That's why you feel so tired. That's why you feel that even though you work and do a lot of stuff, you don't feel complete. That's why sometimes you don't feel the love of the Father inside you. And sometimes you feel rejection from the people beside you. That's why when people came to you with a lot of trouble, you don't care too much because you are so tired. Lord, send us here to love. So enjoy this moment. A moment in his presence. A moment in his presence. something that is going on in your mind. That is taking the peace that the Lord has given to you. Even though you rest, even though you do the things that you have to do, it's not complete peace in you. And believe me, that is not from God. That is from the darkness. And it has to go out in the name of Jesus. We want to pray for you. Because the first thing that the enemy does in our lives is taking us from the peace that the Lord has given to us. That's the first attack. He wants to steal us, and he wants to steal our peace. And when you don't feel peace, you feel heavy. That is something that doesn't let you. Being completely peace is not from God. I'm not saying that you have something in you, inside you. No. I'm saying that the darkness tries to manipulate us from outside and stealing our peace. So we want to pray for you. So I want to invite, if anyone in the worship team, of anyone that is serving here, or anyone that is in this place, that feel that you don't have the peace that you used to, and you don't feel completely in peace, let us pray for you. We didn't plan this, but the Holy Spirit is not letting me go more. Because sometimes we need to do things in order to go further. So we want to pray for you. So come on. Don't be ashamed. Don't be shy. We want to pray for you. Like I say, if it's anyone in the worship team or any server back in the sound or in here, you can come up to the front. We can pray for you. Cannot go further if we don't have the peace of the Lord, because that's the premier attack that the enemy does, and if we don't deal with it, we cannot go further. And if we don't deal with it, we cannot be used as the Lord wants us to be used. When I go higher, we need Jesus. So start asking the Lord. Plead first for forgiveness. that all the things around you are taking the place that is for the Lord Jesus. Second, forgiveness, because you are getting worried for things, and the Bible says that you get worried for anything. That the peace from Jesus Christ comes to you. There are three things. Just repent, because you are not seeking God and you are not putting Him in the first place. Second, you let that other things take the first place in your life. And third, ask that the peace of Jesus Christ comes to you. But you have to ask Him. The Bible says that if we confess our sins, He's willing to cleanse us. So you have to open your mouth and declare. Don't wait until the pastor pray for you. Because if you are waiting in a man to pray for you, that Jesus can do it. So you need to pray. You need to open your mouth and declare and ask for it. You need to do it. And believe it. Because it's not like we have a magic wand and just start touching people like that. No. You have to be willing and also asking, and also have a heart open to what the Lord is going to do. And don't get distracted. The first thing that the enemy wants you to get is distracted. So don't get distracted. So just pray. Thank you.
grace. Release your glory, Lord, this morning. The peace that the world cannot give. Only you, Lord, right now, in Jesus' mighty name. The peace that is not coming from a situation, the peace that is not coming from a pill, but the peace of Jesus right now in our hearts. We want more of you, Jesus. We want more of your spirit. You are the living water in our hearts. You are the living water in our lives. Like a new wine in our hearts. The Bible says, be anxious for nothing, and we want to be anxious for nothing. You are in control of everything, God. You are controlling everything in our hearts. You are controlling our destiny. You are controlling our decisions right now. So we pray right now that we can rest in you, Lord. We can rest in you, knowing that you have the control in our lives. You have the control in our marriage. You have the control of the church. You have the control of your people. You have the control of our jobs, our financials. Come on, rely in Him. Rely in everything. He said, Lord, I leave everything in your hands. Come on, the Bible says, be anxious for nothing, and you can rely in the Lord. You can rely in the Lord. And you can say, Lord, I leave everything in your hands. Come on, just take a moment to pray. Take a moment to pray. Leave everything in God's hands right now. Maybe you've been worried about your friends, of your family, your dad, your mom, something that is happening in your life, and you don't know how to handle it. But you can rest right now in the Lord. Says, God, I will believe right now that you are working, that you are taking the control of this situation in my life, that you are helping me by the Holy Spirit, that you are moving on my behalf, that everything will be okay because you are Lord, because you are my Lord, you are my Father, you are my Savior, you are my healer, you are the one that it put me here, you will sustain my heart. The Bible says that you will never leave me, you will never forsake me, Lord. A few minutes more, the glory is touching your heart right now. So if you still feel anxiety, you feel worried or something, leave it in God's hands right now. Leave it in God's hands right now. Shh, leave the church in your hands, God. The Bible said that you will lead me to all truth. And I pray that you will release right now truth in our hearts to respond to that truth and to obey God in every decision that we make. Santo, Santo, Holy, 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 Holy. The anointing is falling in your heart. It's the new wine. Your Father that are in heaven will supply everything that you need according to your riches and glory. It's not about money only. It's about in every area of your life. He will lead you. If you will lead Him, you will let Him. He will be the cloud. He will be the fire. The same cloud that He lead Israel, the same fire that He lead Israel, and the same person that's going to lead your life if you obey, if you are willing to listen as Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Come on, 1 minute more, 1 minute more, the anointing is flowing. Father, bring peace to every person here, Lord. Come on, just take a moment to say, Holy Spirit, lead me. Holy Spirit, I want you to be the fire in my heart. I want you to be the cloud in my home. I want you to be the one who leads the way in my life, God. The Bible says that I cannot trust in my own understanding. I cannot trust in my own flesh, but I can trust you, Lord. Jesus said, I will leave you, but I will leave the Holy Spirit. Hey, thank you, Lord. Thank you for Holy Spirit. Thank you for this wonderful GPS, spiritual GPS, Holy Spirit. So we leave all our worries. Hey, we leave all that we've been carrying this week. Yes, we're hoping to see the best. We're hoping to receive the best. But Father, you have the last call. Hope, understand, as he said, God is the one that he gives. God is the one that he takes away. Even either or, I will worship the Lord. Either or, I will honor my Lord. So you can trust the Lord. You can trust. He's faithful. He's faithful. And forever will be faithful in your life. Thank you. We declare, Father, with this morning, faithfulness in the house. We declare that you are faithful. We declare that we will never be away. We always be with you. We always be with you. It's your grace. It's your glory that is moving our heart this morning. Great are you, Lord. You are great. We want to thank you right now for this moment. We want to thank you for what you have done in our hearts and every person here. And Father, we open our hearts for you. We open our hearts to understand what you're going to share with us, Holy Spirit. Jesus, you told the enemy, man shall not live from bread only, but for every word that is coming out of the mouth of God. And we declare that this word that we're going to have to receive is our food, is our daily bread today for our spirits. We want more of you, Jesus. We want more of you. So we want to welcome your Holy Spirit. And thank you, because we are not afraid of the future. We are not afraid of the economy. We are not afraid of what's happening in the world, because we are with you. And the Bible says that if God is with us, who can be against us? If God is with us, declare this with me. If God is with me, who can be against me? If God is with us, who can be against us? Father, you are with us. You are with us. When we are weak, we are strong in the Spirit. When we are weak, we are strong in the name of Jesus. When we are down, when we have fears, we can come to you, because you are a stronghold, because you are a castle, because you are our fortress, because you are refuge, because you are anchor. You are Lord. You are, you are, you are, you are, you are, you are, you are. Great are you, Lord. Great you are. Great, great. Trust the Lord. You can declare this as a great, great. Just these four words, and it's gonna move the glory in our hearts. Applause to the Lord right now this morning. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's take a moment to say, Lord, thank you for the provision this week. I want to thank you for our jobs. I want to thank you for every income source that we have. Father, economy is changing quickly. People are losing jobs. I read in the newspaper this week that the jobless is increasing in the city. But Father, we are not afraid of money. We are not afraid of the economy because you are Jehovah. The Bible says you are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. We will never will have lack of money. Never, ever, ever. It's a promise in the Bible that you will open the heavens. So, Father, we are not afraid of any crisis or something like that. We can sleep well. Today, you release peace, and we take that peace in our financials. You will support us. You will bless us. You will multiply, God, according to your riches and glory. The Bible says that you will supply everything that we need. So we want to honor you today with our tithes and offerings. Because this speaks about my trust in you. Yeah, some people are saving money right now. Some people say, no, I'd rather save my money. I'd rather put my seed in the heavens. Because it's not about me, it's about who he is, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So today, Father, we bring our tithes and offerings to the altar, declaring that with our trust, it's not in the savings account. Our trust is not in the riches. Our trust is our God Almighty, Jehovah Jireh. Come on, declare with me, he is my Lord, Jehovah Jireh. One more time, he is my Lord, Jehovah Jireh. He is my provider. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen. Those that are online, you can do your giving online, cdirevivalchurch.com. Thank you for being a giver. Just remember the promise that God gave us. I remember the promise that God said. He says, you will move from one place to another place. You will go from here to here, and I will provide everything that you need. And it says, your children will never ever will ask, how did we get this? Because I will provide everything for you. And I received that word with my wife in Indiana a long time ago. And we believe it. And we have seen God faithful every time. Every time. I don't know how he does it. The only thing that I know is that he's faithful. The only thing that I know, I don't have any savings. I don't have any money from the past or from nothing. I don't have any houses in Colombia. I don't have anything, nothing. I only have the Lord. And he provides everything in my house. So I'm a faithful testimony of his goodness and my provision. God is good. Let's open our Bibles in Jeremiah. I want to share a little bit quick the word of the Lord. The anointing has been released already. I know there's some kids right now, so I think we have a teacher for that class, so they can go to class right now, so the parents can be, you know, with their mind here and not somewhere else. So if that would be like triple fast, remember the Spirit of the Lord moves really fast, so you have to move fast in the Spirit, amen? So let's open our Bibles in Jeremiah chapter 20. We're going to go to verse 7 right there in verse 9. I believe with all my heart that God is preparing wells. You know wells? Places that are deep enough to pour out his Spirit. Amen? It's just like how you see in puddles when it rains. You know, when you go, when you drive, some of the roads are really, nice and clear, but you can find some puddles, like really puddle, like they're full of water. I believe that's what God is doing. God is preparing places to be wells, to be a big holes, ready, hungry, and thirsty of the glory of God. So when the Holy Spirit reigns, it will be a well, a living well of water, amen, and revival. I believe that's what's happening here. We are preparing our hearts. We are singing. We are worshiping. We are repenting. We are asking for forgiveness. We are preparing our hearts. We are discipling our lives in the word of the Lord, and we are preparing our hearts to receive more of the Spirit. Amen. Some people want more of the Holy Spirit, but they are not ready to receive more of the Spirit. Amen. So it's like it's like buying this. You know, you see these light bulbs. These light bulbs only work with probably 12 bulbs, something like that. But if you want to put 120 bulbs, then you need a different light bulb. If you want to put a 240 bulbs, then you have to change because it's going to toast the same thing. So I believe God is working our hearts, preparing our lives for more. Amen? So you have to be prepared. Say with me, I have to be prepared for more. Yes, I cannot do it for you. You have to do it yourselves. Amen? So if you want more of God, you have to prepare yourself. And I hope God is going to speak to us through this word. And it says in Jeremiah verse 20, chapter 20, verse 7. It says, "Oh Lord, you induced me, and I was persuaded. You are stronger than I. I have prevailed. I am in the silence daily. Everyone mocks me." That's Jeremiah speaking right there. Eh? It says, "For when I spoke, I cried out. I shouted violence and plunder. Because the word of the Lord was made to me a reproach and a derision daily. Then, verse 9, I said, I will not make mention of him, nor speak any more in his name. But his word," say with me, "but his word." But it says, "but his word was in my heart." Say with me, "my heart." It was in my heart like a burning fire. Shut up in my, what he says right there? In my bones. I was weary of holding it back, and I could not. Amen and amen. So we know, I know many of you have read Jeremiah. Amen. Have you read the book of Jeremiah? I hope you have. But Jeremiah, they call it the crying prophet. Eh? But he didn't cry because his unfortunate, painful ministry. But he cried for the nation. And he cried because the nation never listened to Jeremiah. You know, there's a part in chapter 40, I believe, 41, where the people say, "Jeremiah, what the Lord says, whatever the Lord says, we are going to do it." And I believe Jeremiah smiled when I heard that. Whoa, hey, finally. And God, and Jeremiah went and he asked the Lord, and God gave them the message. And when Jeremiah delivered the message, the people got mad with him. He says, "Oh, Jeremiah, you don't want the best for us." And Jeremiah, he was a crying prophet. He cried for the nation. And at one point, he suffered so much that he said, "God, I don't want to preach your word anymore. I just cannot do it. You know, my heart, my life," it says, I shout and it says, "violence and plunder. Everybody's against me. Nobody wants to listen." But I like what he says in verse 9, Jeremiah. Because he says, but his word was in my heart. Like what it says right there? Like a burning fire. And it says, shut up in my bones. Listen, Jeremiah didn't want to preach the word. He was tired of persecution. He was tired of the nation not to listen to him. But he couldn't do anything else because he said something. "Your word, Lord, I cannot do any of this anymore. But I cannot live to teach. I cannot stop teaching your word because my heart is what? On fire." Say with me, "my heart is on fire." Well, that's what I'm speaking today, because God is waiting for us to have fire in our hearts. Say with me, fire in our hearts. Listen, many Christians today, they only think that Christianity is about a word. It's about, I'm Christian, I'm going to church, but they don't have any fire in their hearts. And God is waiting for us to be like Jeremiah. Say, God, your word is fire in my heart and even going in my bones. Listen, God is waiting for us to be on fire. Say with me, on fire. And the Bible says in the Hebrew word for fire of God is called ash. That's the word of Hebrew. So Jeremiah is saying, but your ash is the fire of God. Listen, you have to understand something. There's different kind of fires in the Bible. But the ash word, which is the Hebrew word, that's the ash of the Lord. That's the fire of God. You know, when some priests came to the altar to offer to do an offering in the altar, and God didn't receive the offering. The Bible says that an ash came out of the temple. It's not a regular fire. It's the same ash that he was in the burning bush. When Moses was in the mount and he saw the burning bush, and he said that the bush was on fire, but the fire didn't consume the bush. That the fire is called ash. Say with me, ash. And that's the ash that is in Moses' heart. Since that moment, that same fire that he was in that burning bush is staying in Moses' heart. That's why Moses was willing to go before Pharaoh, the strongest and the most powerful man on earth. And Moses went there over there to say, let my people go. Why? Because he got a good mentality. Why? Because he went to Bible college. Why? Because he read the word of the Lord. No, because he had an ash. Say with me, ash. He had an ash in his heart. It was the fire of the Lord. In Matthew chapter 24, verse 12, Jesus spoke about this ash ending. About in the church. Look what it says there. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow. What it says right there? Cold. Listen, God is speaking right there that the end times. And I believe we are living the end times. Amen. We're believing the prophetic time that Jesus spoke about. We are living those times where the fire, the ash of God is no more in the hearts of men. It's just the knowledge of God. I remember I teach a word when it says, I think it was Hosea who said this. It says Hob. It says, yes, I hear about the Lord, but now I know him. And listen, Jesus came to a nation, Israel, where he has many Pharisees, many of the religious people. And they say, oh, I'm fine. You know, I'm the priest of the temple. You know what? Jesus couldn't find God in their hearts. He said, they worship God, but their hearts are far away from it. They lost the ash of the Lord. Yes, they have God in their minds. They have God in their hands. But that's just the Logos word. Because Jeremiah had the rhema in his heart. He said, I have the ash. Say with me, ash of the Lord. But Jesus saying this in the last times, because the loneliness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. And I believe that's what the enemy is trying to do among our hearts. I believe that's the enemy. When, you know, I believe, I like what happened this morning, because God is releasing peace in our lives. Amen. And because the enemy wants to put us job, wants to put an agenda, wants to put a busy, lazy, well, a bunch of stuff to get us cold. You know, when in winter, if you don't turn on your heat, you're going to get cold. If you don't put a blanket, you barely can sleep. You know, when it's minus 20 degrees out there, if you don't put your heat on, your life will be cold. So the same way God is waiting for us to start a fire in our hearts. And that's a fire of a moment. It's not a fire of an experience. Yes, God touched you here. He said, well, I received from the Lord. No, the ash. It's an ash that he needs to burn every day. Say with me, every day. Come on, say with me, every day. And Leviticus chapter 6, verse 13. is Lord, the Lord commanding his people. And God is commanding everyone here, from the little ones to deacons, ushers, pastors, and everyone in the body of Christ, to keep the ash of God burning. Look what it says right there. It says, a fire shall always be burning on the altar. It shall never, what it says right there? Come on, it shall never what? Go out. Have you been in a birthday when you want to put a, you know, you want to turn on the candle and somebody really funny, just blow your candle. You say, no, wait, we need it. And you're like, you know, that's the plan of the enemy. The plan of the enemy is to blow your candle, and Monday, and Tuesday, and Wednesday. And some people try to believe with the ash of somebody else. You know? Many people are coming on Sunday, and they're hoping that the ash of God is stay there until the next week. But God is asking us today to keep the fire of his glory burning every day. Say with me, every day. In our hearts. And the responsibility, I spoke a long time ago about this, is the responsibility is in our hands. Remember the parable of Jesus? 10 virgins, they were sleeping, you know, and only 5 had oil in their hands. Only 5 could put light in the lamps. The other 5 fall asleep. The other 5 didn't do it. The other 5 maybe just like, you know, trust that it was enough oil. And when the Lord came, the other 5 had to come back for more oil. And when they returned, the door was what? Closed. We need to understand something, this church, that the enemy is trying to kill our fire. And I'm not speaking about emotional fire. I'm not speaking about our Christianity fire. I'm speaking about the ash of God. About the fire that the Holy Spirit put in your heart one day. The Holy Spirit put this ash in our hearts in 2012. That way the Holy Spirit came to our hearts. That way the Holy Spirit spoke to our lives. He baptized us in fire as John the Baptist prophesied. And that day, it was a war. Say with me, war. Yes, it was a war with the enemy. Every time comes with difficulties and doubts and fears and problems and agendas and something that is trying to blow my candle. But I had to grab the enemy from the neck. And I have to say, you cannot blow the ash of God in my heart. Because that's the ash of God. Say with me, the ash. Listen, I'm not speaking, I'm not talking about emotions. Some people think there's the fire of God, but it's not. It's just emotions. That's why they are so fired, you know, in a conference. They go to a conference, they jump, dance. And by the end of the week, not even the church can worship the Lord. Because it was just emotion. But some of us, we can have the ash of the Lord that even in the middle of the darkness, even in the middle of our living room, when nobody's watching us, when nobody's looking, we can glorify the name of Jesus. When we can experience the glory of God. Listen, there's many people that only worship God in the church. It's only people that they don't feel God at all during the week. Why? Because they have lost the ash. Jesus promised something. I'm going to be with you all the days. Say with me, all the days. For me, that means 24/7. I can have communion when I'm driving. And actually, sometimes I have, and I have to open my eyes because I want to close it, but I'm driving. But the ash of God is in our hearts. Say with me, the ash of God is in my heart. That's the Hebrew word for the fire of the Lord. And Revelation 2:4. The Lord is putting a high mark. You know, I believe this is in red and maybe in capital letters for the church. Because God is saying this. Jesus is saying this. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Yes, they did everything. They went to disciple, they came to Wednesdays, they came to Tuesday morning prayer, they came to the fasting time, they came to serve the Lord, they worship, maybe they play the instruments, but guess what? They lost the ash of God. And I believe Jeremiah is saying, it's the ash of God, it's in my heart. Even where? In my bones. It's the anointing of the Holy Ghost. So how can we be, how can we keep our, the fire of God in our hearts? How can we keep alive the edge of God in our minds, in our hearts, in our family, in our marriage, in our children? So we meet the presence of the Holy Spirit. Look what it says in 2 Samuel 22:13. The Bible says this. The Bible says, from the brightness before him, coals of fire were kindled. From the brightness before him, coals of fire were what? Kindled. You know, the face of Moses shined not because he read the word, not because he was the leader of the nation. Moses shined because he was in the glory of God. Because the edge of God always stay in his heart. And we need to understand something, church. Holy Spirit is the only one who's going to keep this ash burning every day in our lives. Sunday's meeting is not enough. Wednesday meeting is not enough. Prayer in the morning is not enough. We need to be connected with the Holy Ghost 24/7. Everything that we do affects the ash of God. That's why the Bible says we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. Before some people, they are not temple anymore. They are just a hotel. It's true. Some people say, yes, I am the temple of the Holy Spirit. Yes, but only by visitations every weekend. That's a hotel. But the Bible says that we are temple. Say, we meet temple. And the Bible says in Leviticus, you have to keep what? The burning on the altar. It shall never, look what it says right there. Can you put Leviticus, please, again? It shall never, what it says right there? Go out. And 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 19, I'm closing right there. It says, do not quench the spirit. Do not what? Quench. Do not extinguish the Holy Spirit. So we have to be careful with what we're doing in our lives. The enemy is, tell the one beside you, enemy is smarter than you. It's true. Yes, sometimes you think, oh no, I know everything. Oh no. The enemy is so smart that he's gonna do. Listen, something I'm preparing the workshop for next weekend, and the enemy tempted Jesus. He was willing to pay. Listen, he was willing to give Jesus the whole world if he never go to the cross. You think the enemy is willing to do whatever it takes to blow your candle? Oh yes, he will. He can give you a job, $30 an hour, to keep you away from the church. He can give you a beautiful wife so you don't read the Bible anymore. He was willing to give a lot of ladies to Solomon, and Solomon didn't even notice. But the edge of God in Solomon's heart start what? Extinguishing. At one point, he lost the edge of the Lord. So today, my invitation for you is to keep the edge of God in your hearts burning. That's our responsibility. Say with me, our responsibility. Yes, not your pastors. This is not my responsibility for you. I teach the word of the Lord, but it's your responsibility to do what? To keep the ash burning. I tell my kids grew up already. I used to put them in a shower. And I used to, you know, put soap on Christian and Samantha. I said, no anymore. They are grown already. I don't have to go to Christian and say, Christian, let me put soap. Let me put the shampoo. No, I don't have to do that. His responsibility. I've been telling Daniel, I don't have to tell you when you have to take a shower. Do I? He's growing up. How many wives here say, honey, you have to go to take a shower? No, that's the man's responsibility is take a shower. We all, it's our responsibility with our body. So the same thing, if you are growing in Christ, it's your responsibility to grow the ash of God in your heart. And it's more than, I say, it's more than a Bible school. It's more than a disciple school. It's more than coming on Sundays. It's every moment in the glory of the Lord. So let's take that for a moment, because time is over. I probably have 200 more verses to share, but don't get scared. That's for Spanish. I want to finish with one verse. Say with me, the ash of God. You have to understand that ash is the Hebrew word for what? For the fire of God. It's different kind of fires, you know that? Actually, I think that the hottest part of the fire is blue, I think it's. Right? If I'm not mistaken, it's red, orange, yellow, and it's blue. God is waiting for us to have the ash of God in our hearts. I want to finish with this verse, and I hope God can touch your life today. But it says this in 2 Timothy 1:6, please. It says, therefore, look what the Holy Spirit is doing. Ooh. I remind you to stir up the what? What right there says the gift of God, and the Spanish translation, it says the fire of God. Just put in more, maybe another log. You know, when somebody, sometimes the fire, you know, we've been in a bonfire. And I like the container with the liquid. Because when it's going down, you get like, right? I love it. I love to play with the liquid. That's what it's saying right there. Stir what? The gift. The fire of God. Which is where? In the church? Which is in the Bible? Which is in you. Put your heart right there. It says, He's in me. The ash of God is in my heart. God is reminding us to keep the ash of His glory burning until it goes in our bones. He is a person, His Holy Spirit. He says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. So let's take a moment to be conscious today and say, Lord, like we did before, we repent. I don't have any excuse. Nothing that could be valid, Lord. Yes, I've been busy. Yes, I've been thinking something else. Even sin sometimes is trying to extinguish, quench the ash of your spirit in our hearts. And today we ask for forgiveness. Today is a day of repentance. And Father, we pray that you can forgive us to extinguish from one way or the other way the spirit in our hearts, the fire and the ash of God in our lives. Forgive us if we thought that the fire that we receive on Sunday stay there the whole week without doing nothing. But allow us to understand that we have to worship you, seek you, bless you, honor you, love you every minute in our lives. You ask us to keep the fire burning in the altar, and we are the altar, God. We don't want to be a hotel or a motel. We want to be the temple of the Holy Ghost. We want to have you every day. We want to have communion every day. We want the ash of God. The same ash that it was in Jeremiah's heart. The same ash that it was in Moses' heart. The same ash that it was in Apostle Paul. The same ash that it was in Peter. The same ash, Father, that it was in Jesus Christ. and the same edge that we want to have in our hearts, the same edge we want to have in our children, in our families, in our marriages, in our church. Father, help us. Come on, if you repent already, you can ask the Holy Spirit to help you to keep the edge of His presence in your heart. How? Well, expose yourself to His glory every day. Do not wait until Bible school. Do not wait until disciple time. Do not wait until the class begins. Do not wait until Sunday, until youth group comes. No, 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 no. Every day in close the door of your room. Every day close the door in your living room. And come to the presence of God and come to the presence of Jesus. And seek Him with all your heart. And knock the heavens with your hand. And leave your hand and your voice every morning. And it's a God, keep the ash of your glory in my heart burning. Do not let the enemy extinguish your spirit. I want that fire in my bones so bad, God. I want you, I need you more, 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 more. Come on, stir up, stir up. Come on, stir up right now, the gift of God. Stir up right now, the fire in your heart. Right now, with your prayer. How you do that? With your prayer, with your prayer, with your prayer. Stir up, stir up. Come on, just move the glory of God in your heart. Say, God, I want more. I want more, I want more. Fire in us. Fire in us. The Bible says that you will baptize us in Holy Spirit in fire. And Father, we believe it. We believe in these end times. In these end times, prophetic times that we're living. Whoa. We want to be on fire for you. We want to be like Jeremiah, Lord. We want to say, God, may your word is a fire in my heart. It's a fire in my bones. Hallelujah. Come on, come on. Ask the Holy Spirit. Pastor cannot do anything for you. Holy Spirit can. But you are the one that has to ask for it. Ask for Holy Spirit. Ask for Holy Spirit right now. Come on, ask for the Holy Spirit right now. God is putting fire. Maybe the candle blow out. Maybe you don't have the fire in your heart anymore. But God is willing. And God is willing to say, I will give you a new light in your heart. I will give you a new fire. Not the old one. Not the old oil. But a new oil so you can keep the fire burning in your heart. Come on, come on. Just ask for a moment. We're finishing. We're closing right now. To stir up the gift of God. God is reminding us to stir up the fire of God in our hearts. And the Bible says that it's in us. In us. Come on, you put your heart right there and say, God, fire!